Let's take a look at the empirical rule. The empirical rule is also known as the 68, 95, 99.7 rule. So this rule is only applicable if we know for sure our data follow normal distribution. So this is very, very important. Empirical rule only applies if the data are normal. So if the data are normal, we can draw this bell curve to represent the observations in our data. And right at the center is where the averages are, as you can see. If we convert those numbers in terms of measure of relative standing, we know right at the center, the z-score is going to be 0. Okay, to the right, it's going to be z-scores positive. To the left are negative z-scores. Empirical rule actually says 68% of the observation, that's right here. So all of those observations right here are within plus minus one standard deviation away from the mean. So if they're plus minus one standard deviation away from mean, that means their z-scores are going to be between negative one and the positive one. So 68% of them. That's roughly speaking about two-thirds of the observations. The next number, 95%, 95, represents about 95% of observations are plus minus two z-scores, within plus minus two. And the last number, as you can probably guess, 99.7% of the observations are pretty much plus minus three standard deviations away from the mean. 99.7 is very close to 100%. This also says almost 100% of the observations should fall within plus minus three standard deviation of the mean. So we just interpret those three numbers. Well, not only those three numbers, there are a bunch of some other numbers are given here. So for example, because we know 68% of the observations are within minus one and one z-score, so you should be able to guess that 34% of observations is between zero and one standard deviation. Similarly, you can do a little bit math. You should be able to deduce 2.35% of observation is within two and three standard deviation above the mean. Even though 99.7 is a really big number, very close to 100%, we know on average about 0.15% observation is going to be even more than three standard deviation above the mean. Let's take a look at this example where empirical rule can be applied. So what we have here is a bell curve. It represents the mileage of tires, can be approximated using normal distribution. The center of the normal distribution is 60,000 and the standard deviation is 5,000. The first question, if the level of warranty is said to be 45K, what's the percentage of tires that will be returned under the warranty? So this is the average 60,000. The warranty is said to be 45K, that's right here. To be considered eligible for return under warranty, the mileage of the tire has to be less than warranty, which is 45, so that's going to be here. So less than 45. In order to use the empirical rule, we want to convert all those numbers in terms of z-score. So 60, the z-score is 0. 45 is 15,000 less than 60, and each standard deviation is 5,000. So 15,000 is going to be 3 standard deviations less than the mean. So 45 is going to has a corresponding z-score of a negative 3. So the percentage to the left of negative 3, you may remember from previous slide, is 0.15%. So the answer for part A is about 0.15% of tires will be returned under a warranty. For part B, If we can accept up to 2.5% of tires returned under warranty, what should the warranty level be? So this is average, and we are looking for the warranty level, a new warranty level. If the warranty level is said to be here, the percentage of tires that will be returned under warranty is going to be to the left of that. So that's going to be everything here to the left. Well, it is a small percentage of tires that can be returned under warranty, so the warranty level has to be quite small. And we know that to the left of this warranty level is 2.5%. Well, we know over here is 0.15%. You probably remember between negative 3 and negative 2 is 2.35%. 2.35 plus 0.15 is indeed 2.5. So that means the warranty level should be set here, negative 2 Z score. That is 50K. So the new warranty level should be set at 50,000 miles. Let's take a look at a modified version of previous example. Again, the mean and standard deviations are given here. The warranty level is said to be 52,400 miles right here. And we want to figure out the percentage of tires that will be returned under warranty. In order to use the empirical rule, you probably want to convert this number in terms of standard deviations or z-scores. Well, if you do that, you will realize this new warranty level will not give you a z-score. That is a whole number. Well, without a z-score being a whole number, we cannot use the empirical right away to solve it, because the empirical rule only works for z-score that is 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, and plus minus 3. So we cannot solve it using empirical rule. Similarly, for part B, if we can only accept up to 3%, well, if you look over the numbers from the empirical rule, you know that none of those small probabilities will add up exactly to 3%. So we cannot use the empirical rule. Empirical rule is rather useful, but there are some limitations. Sometimes, if the data do not follow normal distribution, or if the z-scores are not exactly 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, or plus minus 3, we just simply cannot use the empirical rule. And that's why we probably want to use a Excel or Z table to find those exact probabilities. Let's see how Excel functions can help us to find these probabilities. We first draw a bell curve, and X represents all the tire mileage. For part A, we do know the warranty level, and that's going to be labeled using the blue dot here. We like to find the area to the left of this blue dot, this colored in red. This can be done using Norm.Dist function in Excel. Norm.Dist takes four arguments. The very first argument is the value of the blue dot, which is 52,400. The second argument is going to be the mean of the normal distribution, and the third argument is the standard deviation. The very last argument is always true here. Be sure to capitalize the true here. After we enter everything in Excel, we obtain 0.0643. That's the size of the area to the left of this blue dot. Is also the probability less than 52,400. Therefore, about 6% of the tires will be returned when the warranty level is set to be 52,400 miles. Part B is almost the opposite of part A. In part B, we have the area to the left of the blue dot, that's 3%, and we try to figure out what the blue dot is. This time, we're going to use Norm.Inv instead. This function takes three arguments. The first argument is the area to the left of the blue dot, which is 3%. And the second and third are the mean and the standard deviation of the normal distribution, respectively. Using Excel, we find the blue dot, that's the warranty level, is 50,596 miles. We have learned two Excel functions so far. Let's summarize them here. If you know the blue dot, or x, to find the area to the left of the x, We use Norm.Dist. See part A of the previous example for reference. If we like to find an area to the right of x, all we need to do is to find an area to the left of x first, using what we just learned, and then subtract a number from 1. Remember, the total area under the bell curve is always 1 or 100%. On the other hand, if we know the area to the left of x, to find the x, we would use Norm.Inv instead. Please refer to part B of the previous example. Sometimes, we may only know the area to the right of x. To find the x, we use Norm.Inv. In the first argument, instead of putting the left area, we will just put 1 subtract the right area. Let's move on to the next example. Here we have a bookstore. In this example, we assume the weekly demand of this bookstore follows a normal distribution, with a mean of 500 and a standard deviation of 15 copies of book. Part A. If the bookstore stores 530 copies of the news magazine, what is the chance that it does not have enough copies to meet the demand? Not having enough copies to meet the demand means the demand is more than 530. We like to calculate the probability of the demand is more than 530. I'm going to use x to represent the demand. In order to use the empirical rule, we have to convert the actual numbers 530 to its corresponding z-score. And that's going to be 530 subtract the mean, which is 500, divided by 15, which is the standard deviation. And we got positive 2. To find an area to the right of a positive 2 z-score, we can use the empirical rule. You probably remember between plus 2 and plus 3 z-score, the area is 2.35 according to the empirical rule, and the more than 3 z-score, it is 0.15%. So in total, you can sum them up, that's 2.5%. This means, on average, about 2.5% of the time, this bookstore does not have enough copies to meet the demand. Part B. If the bookstore intends to fulfill the demand 99.85% of the time, how many copies should the bookstore have in stock every week? This question is the opposite of part A. We have the probability of 99.85%, and we would like to find an inventory. That means the inventory is less than the demand 99.85% of the time. From the empirical rule, you may remember that the probability of more than 3 z-score is 0.15%. So you can deduce the probability of less than 3 z-score should be 1 minus 0.15%. That's exactly 99.85%. This means the inventory should be set at least 3 standard deviation above the mean. And that's going to be 500, which is the mean, plus 3 multiplied by 15, that's the standard deviation. So that's going to be 545. Therefore, the bookstore should have 545 copies every week if they like to fulfill the demand 99.85% of the time. We're going to change the numbers a little bit and see how we can use Excel functions to solve these problems. For part A, instead of 530, we have 520 here. So we want to figure out the probability of x more than 520. This is the case that we know x, and we would like to find an area to the right of x. So we have 520 here. We want to find an area to the right because it is more than 520. So we can use Norm.Dist function as we discussed earlier. Norm.Dist takes 4 arguments. And after we do that, we get an area to the left of x. But this is not what we wanted. So we want to subtract that number from 1 to get an area to the right. And we were able to find the number is 0.09121. So there is about 9% probability the bookstore does not have enough copies to meet the demand if they only stock 520 copies every week. For part B, in this time, we were able to fulfill the demand 98% of the time. So we do not know the inventory, the x, Well, we have the area to the left of x. So this time, I'm going to use norm.inv to find it. So the first argument, it is the area to the left of x, which is 98%. We change it to 0.98, the mean and the standard deviation. Excel tells us that's going to be 530.81. So therefore, the bookstore should keep 531 copies in stock every week in order to fulfill the demand 98% of the time. In order to familiarize yourself with the empirical rule and norm.dist and norm.inv functions, I'd highly recommend completing the exercise in the practice problems posted on our course site. You can check your answers with the answer keys posted online. This skill set is particularly useful for confidence interval estimation and also hypothesis testing. In the final example of this video, we have a new incentive system in place to reward plant manager whose plant has the greatest relative improvement over the average monthly production. So over here, shown in the table, we have three plants. We have a mean production for each plant, 700, 2300, and 1200. We have their respective standard deviation. We have the production from this month. We also calculate the percentage increase of the production this month compared to the average production. For example, in plant 1, the percentage increase over the average production is about 16%, whereas in plant 3, there is only 10% increase. So based on all the information presented below, which plant should receive the bonus? That means which plant has the highest relative improvement. And why? Well, if you do just use the percentage increase, it is clear that plant 1 should receive the bonus because the percentage increase is the highest compared to all other plants. But in reality, do you really have to do that? Is this the most accurate approach? Percentage increase is indeed one way of comparing that. But more accurate way to do that is probably using z-score. Because we have both the average information, we also have the standard deviation. We can convert the production this month to its relative respective z-score. For example, for plant 1, the z-score for 810 is 810 subtract 700 divided by 200. That's 0.55. For plant 2, that's 0.86. And plant 3, it is 4. So you can clearly see for plant 3, they probably had the highest relative improvement because they were able to produce 1320 when the average is 1200 and the standard deviation is only 30. So the z-score is the highest. So using the z-score, we can see that plant 3 has the greatest relative improvement and should receive the bonus. And percentage increase, on the other hand, is not the most appropriate metric for comparison here. This also concludes the video.